Travis said, Dad, I'm not doing good. I can't breathe. And from the other side of the partition, a voice said, Travis, it's okay. You're going to be all right. Travis said, Dad, you better call 911. I can't breathe. And the voice said, Travis, I'm here. It's okay. You're going to be all right. His father went to call 911. His mother came in to try and help him. She got him out on the floor, lying on the floor. So happened that the paramedics were not far away. They were there within 5 minutes. They came in with a stretcher. They put Travis on the stretcher. Travis' eyes were riveted on his mother. And then the stranger came out from the other stall, went to the head of the stretcher and leaned over and looked into Travis' face. Travis' eyes were now riveted on the stranger, and the stranger continued to reassure him, it's all right, you're going to be okay. The paramedic said, are you his father? He said, no, I'm his friend. They didn't know that my son and some others had been praying that if God didn't see fit to heal Travis, could he give him some special revelation at the end that would bring hope and courage. They took him out to the ambulance, and the stranger followed all the way, leaning over, looking down into his face, and reassuring him. When they got to the ambulance, he was unconscious, and the stranger was gone. They compared notes later and agreed that none of them had seen the face of the stranger. They had only heard him. They took him to a nearby helicopter to take him to a children's hospital 3 miles away. Father and mother got in their car, and at rush hour, they drove the 40 miles in 30 minutes. Which was some kind of miracle. They got there before the helicopter did. They were there when they brought Travis down from the roof, and he died in his mother's arms at 10 o'clock, a young man who had enough faith to not be healed. He had asked that the funeral be on Friday and that it would close right at sundown, which they arranged. The church was packed. There were former classmates who had been off to college who came. There were busloads who came from Walla Walla, even some from Southern. There were 34 of the doctors and nurses from Children's Hospital who came because they had been impressed. A senior class came in down the aisle. In the choir loft, they had one empty chair with a rose on it, and they had the service. My son's turn came, and he shared answers that Travis had given over the months in the hospital, such as, Travis, has your thinking changed much during these times in the hospital? Oh, yes. He said, I used to think that the most important things were, number one, to have fun, number two, to get things, and number three, to be cool. Now I know that the only thing that's important is to know Jesus. And the coolest thing you can do is stand up for him. He said, what do you think of your classmates? Oh, he said, they are awesome to think that they would come and visit me in the hospital like they did on their special day. They are wonderful. And I want to see them all in heaven. And if any of them are not there, I'm really going to be bummed. They had hoped to have a revival and had prayed for it on that campus that year. It came, but they did not know how it would come or that it would happen because of a young man who had enough faith to not be healed. Later, they had a student week of prayer, and students from that class stood up and gave witness. For instance, one of the biggest rebels on campus told of the effect that Travis had had on him. He had brought along his heavy rock CDs, and in front of the students, he crunched them and threw them away. He said, I don't need these anymore. I said to myself, someone from the heavenly country showing up at Toronto at our world conference, yeah, but showing up in this smelly place, he deserved to wear a dark blue silk suit. And then the picture got bigger. Someone from the heavenly country did come to this smelly world. He was born in a manger in a smelly stable. And because of that, we have hope. And Travis had hope. What a story. And it makes you think that heaven is no wider apart today than when the angels sang above the hills of Bethlehem. Once in a while, someone shows up. Are you ready for the poem? See how it fits now. There is a peace that cometh after sorrow, of hope surrendered, not of hope fulfilled. A peace that looketh not upon tomorrow, but calmly on the tempest that is stilled. A peace that does not live in joy's excesses, nor in the happy life of love secure, but in unfailing strength the heart possesses, from conflicts won while learning to endure. A peace there is in sacrifice secluded, a life subdued, from will and passion free. 'Tis not the peace that over Eden brooded, but that which triumphed in Gethsemane. Thy will be done. We know it is not God's will that pain and suffering and death come, but we know that it is his will and his hope that there will be an honor guard who still love him just the same. After telling about this at the camp meeting, a string of people came to the minister's room afterwards. Among them, one woman who was weeping. She said, "I cannot tell you what relief came to me tonight. For 18 years, I have watched my father suffer. He never made one complaint, but I couldn't understand it until now." Listen, neighbor, whether you're in the first half of Hebrews 11 or whether you're in the last part of Hebrews 11, all we can do is hope and pray that we'll have enough faith for either one. Dear Father in heaven, thank you for a little insight that will take the sting out of so many memories. Help us to be able to see through a different set of glasses and to realize the highest honor that can come is fellowship with Christ in suffering. We're thankful for the strength and the faith that's available. In Jesus' name, amen.